crooked cross till my trophies at last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. How many are thankful that it's through the blood that we have access into His presence? And there's this song that's on my heart right now. It's just real simple. Just as I wake up each new day, as You start me on my way, oh Lord, I want You to be with me. How many, that's your prayer? I just want to be with You, God. Before I take another step, nothing matters more than this. Oh, Lord, I want You to be with me. And I have only desired this one thing. Jesus, You are all I'm living for, and I need You more and more each day, for without You I'm nothing. Jesus, You are everything to me, and I don't want You to leave, so Lord, please.
Stand and lift our hands and sing that one more time, that part of the old rugged cross. Why don't you close your eyes for a moment?
I'll cherish the old rugged cross. Trophies at last I lay down. To the old rugged cross.
Come on, clap your hands and praise Him. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Amen. The book of Revelation. I'm sure I will preach, but I'm going to try to teach what I felt the Lord direct me with when I was here Sunday night. And I want to say to your pastor and amen, one of the greatest friends I ever had as well as Joan. And to thankful for them and their friendship and their leadership. They love this church and this city. Amen. Give my honor to my mom and dad tonight. And thank you. Thank you, Brother Bailey. If you can you get me a chair or two? And that'd be awesome. Just one of these chairs would be fine. And the amazing saints of God, we're so thankful for you. I've learned over my years how much value there is in the saints of God that come to the house of God. There's nobody like you. You know, one of these days, the Lord is going to present you to Himself, a glorious church without spot or wrinkle. Amen. You're valuable to God. Do you know that? Look at your neighbor and say, the Lord sure loves you just as you are. He does. He does. And I honor my wife tonight. She's unable to be here. And just circumstances and something happened with one of the programs she ministers in. She's in Florida, and today is our 21 anniversary, wedding anniversary, and we're gonna celebrate in a couple weeks and give honor to Brother Dylan tonight as well. His grandmother passed away last night, Sister Joy Haney. Many of you might have read her books over the years, but it was It was really an unexpected circumstance, sickness in the last few weeks, but she's made it to her reward. Amen. And feel the Lord here tonight. Revelation 3 and verse 13. Okay to do a little Bible reading tonight? Now listen, I'm ADD. Others have diagnosed me ADHD, so I'll try not to read too many verses. Because when I was growing up, somebody read a lot of verses, I turned them off. You're all perfect on all your ways, but I sort of like the preacher getting to the point. But it says, he that hath an ear, what does it say? Let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. And he said unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, write, these things saith the Amen, speaking of Jesus, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. He said, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, ho-hum, mediocre, complacent, just showed up, don't have any fire or passion. He said, I'd rather you be cold than lukewarm. That's right, he said. Just go through the motions. Just preacher, be glad I showed up. And I've been there before. And then it says, so then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. He's talking to the Laodicean church. He said, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. And he said, knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable, and poor and blind and naked. He said, I counsel thee to buy me what? Gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. Verse 19, he says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Everybody say, repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. How powerful is that? I think the tragedy of this is that they're the church, but But yet Jesus is on the outside trying to get back in. How did that happen? How did that happen? The problem is that we get used to what God has given us, and we can get outside of a relationship with God, and that's not the will of God. I'm going to talk to you tonight about personal devotion, but I like to do it from an angle of the Laodicean church. I don't want to go to church or be the church and the Lord be on the outside knocking on the door trying to get back in. And I'm going to prove to you that coffee is a part of personal devotion. Is that all right? Can I go ahead and do it from the beginning? He said, if you'll open the door, I'll sup with you and you with me. Amen. And I believe there's a place that we can spend alone time with God and He can talk to us. Do you believe God can speak to you? So tonight, I'm going to preach to you. I'm going to teach to you. But I want you to lift your hands and say, God, tonight I want to hear from your word. I thank you for your word. I thank you for your goodness. Lord, we're amazed by you and who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. You may be seated. I feel moved in my soul tonight. And if you've served God for some time in your life, you're going to find that there's probably a moment or two in the years that you served God that you became cold on God. How many's ever heard that? How many's ever heard the term lukewarm? Your dad used to preach about it and teach about it, and I had the fear of it. How many's ever heard, man, that church is on fire? Man, they're on fire for God. That preacher's on fire. And they're talking about this same thing, cold or hot. I want to say that none of us are exempt from becoming cold on God. None of us are exempt on becoming lukewarm with the Lord. There was a comedian years ago named Jerry Clower. Anybody ever heard of Jerry Clower? Jerry Clower used to tell the story about a couple driving down the road and how they had been married for many years. And his wife is sitting over in the pickup truck. She's sitting against the door. And she starts saying, I remember when we first got married. And she said. He said, and she said, yeah, we used to sit side by side on the bench seat of the vehicle going down the road. We were so close, and we were always together and up, you know, next to each other. And she's just talking about, I wish it was the way it used to be. He looked at her, and he said, I ain't moved. Somehow over the years, she had scooted to the door. And I'll never forget the one lady, she said, you don't ever tell me you love me. And he said, well, I told you I loved you when I married you. If I ever changed my mind, I'll let you know. And I say, that's not good marriage. And I think it's some way that way with the Lord is that I used to be so close to the Lord. I feel like God looks out of heaven and says, I haven't moved. Who's the one that has got away until he has to come back and knock on the door and say, if you'll open the door, I'll come in. I'll sup with you and you with me. And if we're not careful, we'll make a relationship with God only on Sundays. We'll make our relationship with God on Thursdays or our small group settings or just when we're around people. We're not praying unless people are around. And I want you to know that it has always been the will of God for Him to have a personal relationship with you. And He walks with me and He talks with me and He tells me that I am His own. And you begin to see the love story of Scripture. And there's a book, I can't say I recommend you to read it because sometimes it's all over the map. And I will give a few tips to all of you single people and even the married people here that I don't recommend that you compliment your potential wife or your wife with the Song of Solomon. Song of Solomon will certainly make you blush. But he compliments his bride by saying things like this. Thy teeth are like a flock of sheep. Thy lips are like a thread of scarlet. That was not so bad. But when he said, thy neck is like the Tower of David. Or you have a nose like a tower. I'm going to tell you, when he says your legs are like the cedars of Lebanon, I just don't think you're going to walk out of that room with the response that you want. But and there's more that we could read. But when you read the Song of Solomon, I got a revelation of the Song of Solomon here, and Brother Woodward teach about the Song of Solomon, because it's all about relationship. And I'll get right to the point here this evening. But when you read a verse from Song of Solomon chapter 2, and it goes something like this. It says, as the apple tree among the trees of the wood, so is my beloved among the sons. I sat down under the shadow with the great delight, and his fruit was sweet to my taste. This is the bride talking. This is not Solomon, the husband talking. He brought me to the banquet house, and his banner over me was love. Then she makes this statement. She said, stay me with flagons and comfort me with apples, for I am sick of love. There was a statement of the bride that is reminiscing, because when you really study the story of the Song of Solomon, it's not just a somebody that marries a king. But what you'll find is that the great king in all of his grandeur, there's a lot of talk right now about who's the wealthiest man in the world, and his name's Elon Musk. He passed up Bezos and went on, and I think somebody said he's worth $300 and some billion today. But did you know that Solomon was worth about three times more than he was? And when you study Solomon, he was not just a king, but he was a king of kings. And there's a lot of parallels between Solomon and his bride and Christ and his church when you begin to read it. But what you'll find is Solomon was, there was never a king like him, and never before him, and never a king after him. He had the first zoo. He would send ships around the world, and every 3 years those ships would come and bring exotic animals and spices and dishes. And when you would have come to Jerusalem and see Solomon's temple made of marble and trimmings, it would have been a world wonder. They had never seen a building like it. It was so marvelous that one queen, they called her Candace, but she traveled 1,000 miles without a plane, a train, or an automobile to get there. It would have taken months, and she took a caravan of stuff with her just to see the site of Solomon's temple. And when she got there, she said, there's no more spirit in me. In other words, what we would say here is, it took my breath away. The majesty of Solomon's kingdom was so magnificent that she said, the half was not yet told me. It was worth the trip. She goes on to say, even his wisdom. When you're talking about Solomon, you're talking about everybody was looking to him. Every kingdom was talking about him. Everybody was looking. But when you read this text tonight about this bride who said, give me the flagons and give me the apples. What she was saying was, I'm now in the banquet house. She said, I now live in the palace. I have a personal relationship with the king. We know each other, and he's blessed me more than you could ever imagine. I'm in the banquet house. But if you study the Song of Solomon, what you'll find, he didn't find her in the banquet house. But what he did was he changed his robe. He disguised himself as a shepherd. And he went out into one of the small villages, and it talks about it. But when he gets out there, no one knows who he is, because he's not dressed as a king. He's dressed as a shepherd. And one of those orchards, or one of those vineyards, you know, when you think vineyard, you think grapes, but when you think Solomon's vineyard, that would have meant apples and flagons and grapes and pears and peaches. And there were these places in the kingdom that belonged to Solomon. I mean, he owned the land. It's not like today that you own your property. When it's a monarchy or a king, the king owns your land. How many know that's true? He's the king of the land. You just get to live on his land. But he has disguised himself as a shepherd, and he is walking through the orchard, and one day he starts a conversation with a commoner. She has no clue who she's talking to. She thinks she's just talking to a common shepherd. And she starts this conversation. And I wonder, will you be the commoner for a minute? Be the commoner for a minute. If you only knew how he saw you. You did not go to him. He came to where you are. The Bible says you didn't choose him in John 15. The Bible says that he chose you. Praise God. Well, I came to the Lord. No, you didn't. He came to you. Amen. He came to where I was. He saw me in my mess, in my brokenness, and my commonness, and he came to me. That is how this works. He came to where I was. And she's probably got a basket over her arm, and she's plucking fruit to make a little money, and she's pulling the apples and putting them in the basket. And can you grab an apple? He's probably a little taller than her, so he reaches up one day, and he hands her the apple. She takes it. Now, I'm painting this picture. That's not in there. But something happened. And what I believe is the commoner found the shepherd was interested in her. They built a relationship. Just together. Two seemingly commoners. Until one day he proposes and she says, yes. And when she says yes, he starts revealing who he is. He's not just the good shepherd. He's the King of Kings. It's not long until he's introduced her to the palace. And she writes about, I'm now in the banquet hall. But this is not how it began. Can I just stop for a minute? Do you realize that the king that Isaiah saw in Isaiah 6, he said, I saw one sitting on the throne. Do you realize the King of all of glory wrapped himself in flesh and came down to this earth and walked among men? Praise the name of the Lord. That's why they mocked him. That's why they made fun of him. Because to look at him was just, he was a commoner. They would say, oh, thou Samaritan, and throw off on him. It was amazing because every now and then we get a glimpse of really who he was when he steps out in the midst of the storm and he starts walking on water and even the wind and the sea obey him and he starts raising their dead and healing their babies. He looked like everybody else, but he was the King of glory. He was the King of power. He wrapped himself in flesh. And the Bible says, and God, everybody say, and God was manifest in the flesh. That means made visible in the flesh. And you know who he was? He was the good shepherd. He walked among men. I know we've got a pulpit here today, but I don't believe Jesus stood on the rock cliff and preached it down to everybody lower than him. I'm not talking about the platform. You need to be able to see the preacher. But he didn't just do this from the pulpit. I find in the place where he sat among even the children, set him on his knee. He did. He went to Zacchaeus' house and sat on the well in John 4. And a woman that had five husbands and the one she now had wasn't hers. He went and had a conversation with her. Because he could see beyond the mess. Desiring nothing more than a relationship. And I'm going to come to tell you, he didn't wait for you to get it all together before he came to you. He came to you knowing what he had in the palace. He said, if you come unto me, he said, all you that labor and are heavy laden. Woo! Somebody say amen. Amen. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, he came to where you were. Thank you. This is the gospel. You can be seated. That's the Song of Solomon. And so what you'll find is somewhere in the narrative of the story, She's built this relationship with King. Now she knows who he is. Can y'all see me over there? All right. She knows him like nobody else. She's the bride. She looks now and she doesn't have to pluck apples out of the orchard. Somebody's plucking them for her. She doesn't have to do it. Somebody's getting it for her. She's got the best outfit. She's got the greatest access. You know, when the Bible says he's going to open to you his good treasure, how many of you picture treasure box? Not a treasure box. The king has treasure cities. Not only treasure houses. You realize what she has access to. And she is sitting there now in the comfort. She's now just looks around and there's abundance and there's blessing and there's more. And I'm sure every now and then she sits back and looks and says, how in the world did I get here? But also she gets used to it. Until Solomon can walk in the room and she doesn't even lift her head. Because that's what happens in marriage as well. That's what happened. You know, I was driving down the road, and it's our 21st anniversary, so I got to reminisce here for a minute. I'll never forget, we was going down the road. We used to evangelize, and I'm a little bit slow, and sometimes I can leave the heat on too long in the car and the AC on too long in the car, and I can leave the windshield wipers on when it stopped raining. I'll never forget, we were just newlyweds, and we were going down the road, and how many's ever had the windshield wipers going, we're driving fine. She looked and she said, would you please turn those windshield wipers off? I don't know what come over me. I said, you'll get used to it like everything else. I can't remember what happened after that. Amen. I blacked out, I think. I don't know. We laugh about it now, but the truth of the matter is, you do get used to things. You talked about staying at your uncle's house with the cuckoo clocks. Couldn't sleep the first night. He slept all the way through it. We grew up living beside a train track. When I first moved there and that train would hit that horn, come out of that bed. I thought the train was coming through the bedroom. Got used to it. Buddies come stay all night. Train come through the track. Come down right next to where I live. They jump out of hell, what in the world? It's okay. Because we get used to things. If you can get used to noises and bad things, you can also get used to good things. I'll never forget the story, and I'll never forget the story that I heard years ago about a lady came to church, and after service, she's first time guest. She come up to the pastor in the altar service, and she's weeping and she's crying, and she's trembling. And, pastor, I need to talk to you. And somebody directed her to the pastor. And afterwards, he said to her, how can I help you? We're so glad you're here. And she said, I can't stop crying. I can't stop shaking. And he said, oh, I'm so glad to tell you, that's the Holy Ghost. You're feeling the Spirit of God. God's touching your heart. And she said, why is no one else crying? Why is no one else trembling? Because when you first came and felt the presence of the King, you were moved by what you felt. Joy and peace and patience and love. You walked out or you came and said, I didn't even want to go to that church. They made me. But before you can leave, you thought, I'm going back to that church because I feel something there. There was comfort there. There was peace. What was it? It was the presence of God. But if you stay in church long enough, you can go in with your mind on everything in your world you're trying to maintain and keep up with. And God can move in the room and you don't even lift your head to look up at the King even in the church service. And you're just used to him, used to that. I made it a pact within myself. I don't want to ever get used to praising him or used to going to the house of God. When he moves, I want to lift my hands. I want to acknowledge that he's in the room. Come on, is there anybody here? When they start singing about the old rugged cross, I don't want to just sit there cross. No, I want to lift my eyes to him. Somebody say amen. Amen. God can move and we're not. He can walk into the building and she doesn't even lift her head. Why? Because she forgets how it began. I'm going to tell you, blessing's good until it steals all your time and attention. You can get used to the banquet hall and forget about the one that brought you to the banquet. God, you can get so used to the blessing you forget about the blesser. You can thank God for the gift and forget about the one that gave it to you. Can I preach to you? We need relationship. We've got to have a relationship with Him. Hallelujah. The whole point of tithing is to make sure you remind yourself, I know where it came from. It's the whole point of tithing. It's not just 10%. It's first. That's why Proverbs 3, it makes the statement, it says, give of thine increase. What's it saying? Of thy first fruits. And he said, I'm going to bless you. What was he saying? Is that I return it first to God because I know that I'm at the banquet hall because he brought me here. That's what that's about. It's making sure you're in alignment to say, I didn't get here by myself. He brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on a rock to stay. He put a song in my soul today, a song of praise. Hallelujah. I didn't get here by myself. I know I'm here because he came to the vineyard. He came to the orchard. He picked me up. He brought me to his house. I don't want him to ever think I'm not thankful. Somebody say, I want to be thankful. I want to be thankful. And I say to everyone that feels like, you know, everybody in the building right now, do you realize the reason you're in the building? You might not have arrived at that place of abundance of blessing yet, but you're in that place where he's doing this number. He's feeding you. He's building a relationship with you. It might be through somebody, but he's building a relationship with you. It's just the beginning. That's not the ending. You're not staying in the orchard. You're not staying in the vineyard. You're not just going to be there plucking these things the rest of your life. When you get in relationship with him, you get in. What happens is at some point the relationship turns to a covenant. Yes, I want to be married to you. Yes, only to you will I live. I will not serve any other gods. I will not go any other way. And in that covenant, when the covenant is made, can I go ahead and just preach to you for a minute? So we hear this story, and the thought of this is paralleled all through Scripture. I could go for a long time tonight on the same principle about going from the orchard to the throne room. I could take you from the garden, which is also called a garden, to the throne. Watch this. John 14, Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. He said, if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. That is talking about marriage. It is a preparation place. I just want to stop here for a moment and say there will be streets of gold and gates of pearl and no more dying and no more sickness, no more sorrow. How many know we got a home that's outside of this world? It's called heaven. Somebody shout glory. Now, can y'all help me pull this back? I need to, will you scoot this back a little bit? How? Oh, that's far enough. Would you bring my Bible? Thank you. When you realize, you can be seated, that he wants a relationship with you. If we're not careful, that will change the relationship into a ministry. And all of a sudden, we get this thing called busy. We're busy in the church. We got choir practice, music practice, Christmas practice, Easter practice, programs, ministries. And church can be very busy. Because now you're in the banquet hall. You're on the team. You're serving with the king. And you got a relationship. But all of a sudden, everything about the king is taking care of the banquet hall. It's taking care of everything around. You got everybody, look at your neighbor and say, there's a calling destiny for your life. So watch what happens. Next thing you know, you're in his word only to teach your Sunday school class. The reason that you're reading the Bible, because you need a word to preach midweek service. And you'll find yourself only gathering from the things of God to feed somebody. Until Solomon's no longer in the picture. The king is no longer in the picture. It's only about gathering from the stuff so I can take care. Remember what happened to Judas? Is when Judas became so focused on his ministry, he fell out of relationship with Jesus. I'm going to teach you for a minute. Because when I was 19 years old, I almost backslid. I was helping my dad. When I say backslid, I got cold on God. Did God use me? Yes. Was I out of balance? Absolutely. We were helping Dad pastor 3 churches. I got out of balance. I was in engineering school. And I would read my Bible to get a message to preach. Are y'all hearing me? And God would give me a message to preach. But what I was doing was only trying to feed the church. People would repent. People would come. But I wasn't praying. I was out of balance. I'd do my engineering schoolwork after church. We were in a lot of church. And I don't blame it on that. But I stopped praying to have a relationship with God. And I started praying to fulfill my ministry and my calling. Let me put it this way. The only time I read my Bible and the only time I was praying was, God, would you give me a word to preach tonight? Would you let somebody be healed? Oh, God, let somebody be filled with the Holy Ghost. Oh, God, would you? And I was calling on God not to know him, but I was calling on God to let me fulfill my ministry. And you know what happened? I fell out of a relationship with God. God anointed me to preach, but I was fading away. And I remember to a point, I would lay across my bed at night. I stopped praying, and I'm not going to get into some of that, but I stopped praying, I stopped praying. I learned to get popcorn messages. I learned what I mean is just get up and go. I was busy with school. I was busy with this. I was busy with that. I was busy with teaching Bible studies. I was teaching Bible studies during the week, and I was busy. It's not that I wasn't doing good. It's not that my intentions weren't right, but my devotion was about ministry and not about relationship. I only read my Bible to see if I could get a sermon. Y'all hear me right now? And I got cold on the Lord. All the way, I remember one night that I was laying across my bed, and my mom could tell you, this is how I slept at night. Loosen my tie. Sometimes I'd leave my dress shoes on. I'd take off my jacket because I knew if I got too comfortable, I'd sleep too long, I wouldn't get my work done for school. I was in engineering school. I'd lay crossways in my bed. And one night, I fell asleep. And I used to listen to preaching when I go to bed at night. And I stopped listening to preaching because I'd get so stirred it'd make me want to get up and pray. So I'd be praying in the middle of the night about some sermon. And I got away from that. And I'll never forget one night, I fell asleep and went through a spiritual attack. Spiritual attack. Felt like I couldn't get out of bed. I felt like I had a spirit pressing me against the bed. And I remember waking up, but I couldn't move. I felt like a spirit had attacked me. And I knew if I could just say Jesus, I was going to be all right. I couldn't get it out. You might think I'm crazy, but it really happened. And I couldn't. I remember in my mind, if I could just see Jesus, I'd get it out. All of a sudden, I heard preaching. It's like come across that tape player I had. Y'all know what a tape is? It said, you can declare war without God. You can declare war, but without God, you can't win the war. You can declare ministry, but without God, you can't do it. See, and that's the problem, is sometimes we learn to do things for him, but not with him. You can do ministry for God in the absence of God. I've been to those beautiful buildings over in Europe, dry, dead, and cold. 4-foot wide marble pillars, huge ceilings, and nobody goes. Graveyards outside of it where they buried the saints of old, because what started in the vineyard died in a banquet hall. What started in an upper room died in an amazing church building. What started in a prayer meeting dies in a church service. How? Because we learn to do things for Him instead of learning to do things with Him. Can somebody say amen? You know I'm telling you the truth right now. Mom and Dad, I tell you all, maybe never shared it, but I'll never forget the day I made up in my mind that I'm going to be an engineer and I'll preach on the side. And whenever I get time, I'll preach. But I'm going to be an engineer. I'm going to make this much money. This is what I'm going to be. This is what I'm going to do. And what happened is I made ministry a job and not a calling. It's as if I have time, because now I've got away from God and I'm now doing my own thing, because not that I wasn't doing it for Him, I was doing it in the absence of Him. Because you can learn to operate in the gift and not relationship. Can I talk to you? Because that's what happened to Laodicea. The Laodicean church, he said, you say I'm rich, I'm increased with goods, and I have need of nothing. I've got it all settled. That's what the Laodicean church. You know why? Because the soil of the Laodicean church was so fertile, it produced the best wooled sheep in all of the land. They sold so many sheep, they had so much money. It became a banquet hall. It became the mercenary center of that entire Middle East. And they were in abundance, and they felt like they had no need. But the problem was they had learned to live in the blessing of God without God. Hey, would you do me a favor? Would you step outside the door for a minute? You're going to be the Lord. Why do you look so surprised? Amen. Would you knock on that door? I wonder who's trying to get into the cross church. I wonder who's trying to get into my calendar. I wonder who's trying to get in my mornings before I start work. I wonder who's trying to get into my day. I wonder who's trying to get into my teenagers. I'm not leaving you out of it. I wonder who's trying to get into my life. And we hear the knock at the door. Oh, we're thriving. I don't have any needs. Man, I'm doing great. I feel so blessed. My goodness. And all of a sudden you hear, now, who is it? It's the Lord. Oh, we're good. You know, some people live for God that way. When they were in the orchard and in love, because all of a sudden they brought it out, they're so thankful. Then all of a sudden, I'm not so sure that when people don't get it together, get the act together, that they do something like this. Hey, Lord, thank you. I'll take it from here. I've got it. Thank you. See you later. In our relationship with God, you can learn to go to a church service and never sing the song. Never feel, never reach, never get it, because you're just going to church. Oh, I don't want to ever get to a place where I'm doing stuff for Him, but He's on the outside of what I'm doing. I want Him on the middle of everything I'm doing. I want to be hand in hand. Let's stand to our feet and say, God, I want You with me. I want You with me. I don't want to be a Laodicean church. Woo! Somebody shout, the banner over me is love. There's a banquet house. And Dad, I've said it publicly, and I don't know if I've ever told you, but that was 19. And I told the Lord I'll preach, but on the side. And I was listening to a tape when I'd made my mind up. And Dad asked me to preach. I was still preaching. I just, not on fire like I was. I was still preaching all the time. But I didn't have the zeal. I was ministering every day. But something was lost. You know what it was? Relationship with him. And I heard a message by Anthony Mangan in a little side office there up on Charlton Heights Hill. He said, who's going to bear the ark? Who's going to take the responsibility? Who's going to go? Who's going to be at the prayer? Who's going to do this? And I repented. Don't judge me too harshly. But I was in the agony. You can be seated a moment. Have a few more minutes. That makes me apostolic preacher when I say I need 5 more minutes. I need 10, I think. Nobody was in the building. Mama, I was in such agony because I knew it wasn't right. And I got on the floor and I made a covenant with God. I don't know how I got here. But Lord, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll be what you want me to be, and I'll do what you want me to do. It's not going to be what I want. I'm going to let you lead me like you did out of the orchard to the banquet hall. And I literally rolled in the floor. There wasn't anybody there. I was in agony. I'm missing it. Oh, God, forgive me. I've learned to do church with no relationship. God, from this day forward, the ministry is not going to be ahead of our relationship. Preaching is not going to be more important than our devotion. Oh, God, I will not back and forth. Might sound silly to you, but I was stirred in my soul because you can preach and be lost. You can teach Sunday school and backslide. You can sing on the praise team and not be right with God. You can go to church and not be where you need with Him. You got to make sure I'm in a relationship with Him. This is not about ministry. This is about relationship. And I made a covenant with the Lord. And I told God that day, I'll never do this again. Hope my preaching doesn't reflect what I'm going to say. But I have not studied for a sermon since I was 19. Dad, I haven't studied to preach since I was 19 years old. But I tried to practice what you did from that day forward. Now you can mock it. I don't think you will. I decided to read my Bible to know the Lord because His Word will always match His voice. Not trying just to get my chapter in, because that's religion. I would read, and sometimes I'll read to the Lord and said, stop. Sometimes it might be a chapter. Sometimes it might be a book. Sometimes I've stopped at 5. You can be seated. Sometimes I've stopped at 5 verses because I feasted on it. And all day long, can y'all relate with what I'm teaching? All day long, those verses would speak to me. And I chew on it because the Bible says His Word's like honey to the lips, strength to the bones. And I'd pray. And the messages that I now preach, they don't come from study and sermon. They're the overflow of my devotion. So I submit to you tonight as I come to a close, ministry is what I do in the overflow of my devotion. Don't ever get it backwards. Because if you get it backwards, you'll do it for God, but without God. But the Bible says, with God, all things. Let me tell you what happens when you do ministry for God. Will you turn this way? Look this way. All right. You know where I'm facing? All right, now look back at me. Are you with me? I'm on a treadmill. How many's ever run 6 miles on a treadmill? I don't think I have. How many's ever run a mile on the treadmill? I know Mama does. What? Listen, as I'm closing, I promise. You can go miles, sweat, energy, and go nowhere. And that's what ministry is without relationship. It's a lot of spent energy and words and passion and compassion that will always cause you feeling empty with no results. But give me somebody that'll get along with God, So it was that day and time I'd get up at daybreak and my eyes would open. The clock so consistently would be 5:30. Didn't need an alarm. I was just a teenager, but I'd look at the clock and say 5:30. And I got back into that and I'd get up and I'd fix me a cup of coffee because I even think Jesus likes coffee. Show me verses where he doesn't, amen. He said, knock. Would you knock on the door? Would you knock on the door? Come on, knock on the door, your heart. That's what he's doing tonight. That's what he's doing to people that have been in church for 30 years. Did you hear me? That's not the Laodicean sinner. It's the church of Laodicea. And I hear him say, he that hath an ear, let him hear what I'm saying. And I wonder tonight, whether you're in the orchard and he's interested in you, or you're in the palace and you know him for years, are you still wanting to hear what he's saying? Because sometimes my greatest moves of God are when no one else is around. It's called devotion. I don't want to be a Laodicean church. And God, tonight, you might look at me, and I'm sitting there with a cup of coffee and now glasses, because my brother was right, my wife was right. My eyes are getting worse. Right now, I'm reading Psalms. And out of Psalms is going to come sermons and words for people I pastor. I'm going to say, just like in Psalms 3, whatever, what I'm saying to you is that don't ever lose your relationship. What started in the garden in the Genesis ended in the throne in Revelation. Tree of Life, read it. You can find it there. Genesis 2 and Revelation 22. But what I hear tonight in this church, I hear a Song of Solomon chapter 2. Give me the apple again. I hear the bride saying, would you take me back to the flagons? Take me back to when I was just a commoner. And I was so excited just to know the shepherd. Somebody interested in where I was. Not in the palace. When I'm so busy that I forget about who he is. I come to the cross church. Your greatest days are not behind you. Your greatest days are ahead of you. But the king is looking out tonight. And he just wants to know, is anybody in the room want to have a relationship with him? I wonder who would lift your hand and say, God, I don't want to get. Come on, I want you to lift your voice. Oh God. Come on, somebody open your heart and your spirit right now. In the name of Jesus. Come on, the Lord's in this building right now. I wonder who'll come and get on your knees and start over. Come on, I wonder who'll come here and say, God, sometimes I want to go back to the orchard. I want to go back to the vineyard. But I didn't know. I didn't know what ministry was. I didn't know what all of this was. Come on, that's it. But I didn't know. Oh, God, come on, what recovery looked like truly. Blessed and abundant grace and mercy and new beginnings and restoration. My emotions are back. My mind is back. My health is back. Oh, God. Thank you.
Feel protected. Jesus, you are.
You are
the hope that I cling to. Lord, you mean,
you mean
more than this world to me. I wouldn't trade you for silver or gold.
Just worship the Lord right now. Can we sing it?
Oh, the love of my life.
The Lord, you are.
You are the hope that I cling.
The Lord, you mean.
You mean more than this world.
I couldn't live.
lift our hands one more time and thank God for one more soul. Thank you, Jesus, for your touch in this place tonight. Thank you, God, for your word. God, it's forever settled in heaven. God, I pray you do it today. Thank you, Lord, for your touch here. Praise the Lord. I just want to say thank you to my brother Aaron. Thank you for coming and ministering to us tonight. You bless my soul. And how many's ready to read your word? I told somebody one day, they was asking me, they was just asking me, how do you preach? How do you preach that many times? How do you do it? I said, well, I do ministry every week. Sunday mornings, I'll finally sit down for a few minutes and I'll put it all together on Sunday morning. He said, what are you talking about? I said, I just get it out of my devotion. And I remember you saying that years ago, Aaron, many years ago. And I'm thankful for daily devotion and walking with God. But it just stirs my heart. I just don't know. It almost make you want to read the whole book of Leviticus, don't it? Folks, that's funny. Praise God. Brother Dylan, thank you for being here and singing. And I didn't mention nothing before church, but we're so sorry for your loss, and I can't even imagine. And we've had a loss in our life, but we're praying for you. And we know she's in a better place, don't we? Praise God. Can we lift our hands one more time in dismissal? God, we love you so much. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, God, for the peace we feel. God, I thank you for what you're going to do the rest of this week in our lives. God, I pray you bless every person financially. You bless them with good health. God, give them peace when they sleep. God, take them home safe. Bring them back safe, I pray. Keep your hand upon them, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.